y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy, folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden he break off in a song something like this.
Reading a journal, and the journal talked about how young adults were feeding the church at record numbers of every location, how that so-called mega churches are even on the decline. It appears, and it seems like that the Word of God is not what it used to be. Even in the body of Christ, the Church of Christ, average attendance across the nation, somewhere between 31 and 51 people. And I'm wondering that each morning that the pulpits announcing, why isn't the Word of God working? And then I begin to study, I begin to realize that it's not the Word of God, but perhaps what's being preached is the Word of God. So if you have your Bibles with you and you're following with me, we look at our text, we'll find an interesting verse of Scripture. And I only want to look at this verse, and we know the background, and there are those who've come into the church and they're trying to reestablish the Sabbath days. There's a teaching concerning the Sabbath days that the rest belongs to Christ. And he allows us to enter into the rest. But he says something that I think should be highlighted, should be spotlighted this morning. He says, for unto us the gospel is preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard. Now let me read that again. He says, the word of God was preached unto us as well as unto them. Who is the them? He is not referring to the world, but those who are espousing another doctrine or teaching, who intend to pervert the gospel of Christ in the book of Hebrews. And he said, let me make it totally clear to you that the word has been preached. We preach the word from Samaria. We preach the word in Thyatira. We preach the word in Ephesus. We preach the word in Philippi. We preach the word. The word was preached. That Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That Jesus Christ is our high priest. And Jesus Christ is a better hope and a better covenant and a better promise. That Jesus Christ is the church, and the church is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Am I right about it? Mm-hmm. We preach the word. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, as you go preaching, take no script, take no preparation for what you might say, for the Holy Spirit would guide you. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
The word has been preached. And I stopped by to tell you this morning that the word is being preached this very hour.
Amen.
All over the nation, men of God are up preaching the word of God. But listen to what the Bible said. The Bible said the word was preached unto them as well as unto us, but it did not profit. Mm. What happens when the preached word is not profitable? Some would blame it on, well, the preacher's preaching, but he ain't living a life. Nowhere in the Bible does the Bible give the power to the preacher.
Amen.
But the power is in the gospel.
Amen.
There's nothing but an excuse of heathenism to reject the word of God. For the Bible says, for I am not ashamed. No matter the life that Paul had led, he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Romans 1:18. For it is the power. Wait a minute. He said, for I am the power.
For it
is the power unto what?
Salvation.
Unto salvation, to the Jew first and unto the Gentiles. Well, some have said, well, the preaching's not working anymore because the preaching has become irrelevant. Am I right about it? Paul warned them in 1 Timothy chapter 4 when he said, let me tell you, there are some folk who who will have itching ears, that will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned unto faith. Am I right about 2 Timothy chapter 4? He said, but watch thou in all things, do the work of an evangelist. But way before he said that, he said, I want you to continue to preach the word and to be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long suffering. For the time will come when men will not endure sound doctrine. But right about it up. But they'll get teachers for themselves, having ill. Why is the word not profiting folk? It can't be, it's because of the preacher. Because the preacher don't have the power. Right about it. Why are folk turning their back on the word of God? Because that is not, it can't be the word is irrelevant, because God's word is sure. Am I right about it? Every word of God is pure. Every word of God is true. Somebody said it. Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 16, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. God will have an inspiration that has an expiration date. You know what I'm saying? God's word was good then, and God's word is good right now. Why is preaching not working? Well, at least one thing. God never put the power in man. He never put it in the relevancy of the text, because his word is always relevant. The reason he says that it did not profit was because it was not mixed with, y'all back in the text? Mm-hmm. Before, it was not mixed with what? Not mixed with faith. Now watch this. Perhaps, bear with me, my father, perhaps preaching is not working because we've changed what we're supposed to be preaching.
Amen.
Y'all all right?
Mm-hmm.
We allow the Billy Grahams, Joel Osteen, Creflo, Squeezer Dollar, and everybody else to preach stuff that is not congruent with the Bible. Mm-hmm. And we ourselves in the Church of Christ like that kind of preaching. In fact, it is not even preaching, it's called motivational speaking.
Amen.
All someone has to do is get up and tell a good story. And in that good story, folks will start crying. And say, I like that kind of preaching. But when I look through the scriptures, the only story that I see told in the scriptures is the story which was the truth about a man that came down from glory. But God so loved the world, he gave his only. Y'all I like that story. Y'all I like that story. He gave his only begotten son. He came down, made himself sin, fashioned like me, but he was God all by himself.
Amen.
Bible says he had a spirit in him. Colossians 2, verse 5, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus. Though he was God, equal God, thought it not robbery to take on the form of a son. We ought to tell that story. But somebody said, well, we do tell that story, but when we tell that story, and we started to tell the story in the emphasis of not salvation, but we started to tell the story about Christ in the form of profitability. Mm-hmm. Prosperity preaching is not found in the scriptures.
Amen.
Yes, we can prosper, but there's not one sermon that any of the apostles preach about how to get rich.
Uh-huh.
God, I say amen.
Amen.
But for whatever reason, we love sermons about how to get rich.
Mm-hmm.
We love sermons about how to have a good life. We reduce God from God of the universe to somehow a spiritual piggy bank who is empowered. Whenever we do something good and make him happy, he gives us. And when we do something bad, he takes from us.
Right.
Our people sit in the pews from the 1990s and now and heard how to get rich if they just make God happy.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been making God happy through making the preacher happy for about 20 years. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
They're buying $1 million jets, saying, what if God want me to have $1 million jet? In Jesus' day, I remember him asking folk to get him a boat, $1 million boat to get him to the other side.
Amen.
But he rolled over what he had on a fisherman boat, or he walked on land down Jericho Road, mm-hmm, and preached the gospel with what he had. Am I right about it?
Amen.
We changed what we preached. We told folk down in Dallas, Texas, woman, thou art loose. And we loosed her in the pulpit.
Uh-huh.
We changed that's not the word of God to take an introspective look at what is being preached and not who's preaching. Am I right? They changed what is being preached. They now have allowed women to serve as bishops and deaconess. But when I read the scripture in 1 Timothy chapter 3, if a man desired office of a bishop, he desires a good work. Am I right?
Yeah.
Likewise, the deacons must be the husband of one wife. But we changed what's been preached. And now it says, okay, if a man love a man and a woman love a woman, nowhere did God preach same-sex marriages.
Amen.
We changed what was preached. Don't preach it at all. Nobody preaches Romans chapter 1 around verse 21. For when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, but they burned in lust. Woman laying up with woman and man laying up with man. We change what we preach because we don't have faith in God's word like we used to have faith in God's word. Am I right about it? I remember the old folk used to say, God said it, that settled it, and I'm finished with it. Am I right about it? But we want the word to be effective. We've got to preach the word, the unadulterated word that calls men to change their lives, change their mind, and live in a conscious about God.
Yeah.
But we begin to preach first saved by grace. We would say to folk, there's so much grace. There's got so much grace. It don't matter what you do. You just keep on living any kind of way you want to. And God's grace will cover you. Well, that's true. God's grace will cover you. But grace without faith is waste. Grace without obedience is waste. There's not enough grace that allow you to play the grace card in order to be saved. Am I right about it? Romans chapter 5 and 23rd verse. Seeing that we have so much grace. He said, where sin abound, grace did much more abound. But in Romans 6 and verse number 1 says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Galatians chapter 5. He said, let me tell you some seed that some of you have fallen from grace. Am I right about it? Some of us have wasted grace. We stopped preaching what grace is and how grace works. And we just, even in the church, just have our grace preachers. And we have some expert grace preachers down in Dallas, Texas. All these, but the grace of God, that's good. But grace without faith is waste.
Amen.
Grace must have obedience. So if you won't preach the word, if you won't preach the prophet, you've got to stop profiting off of preaching.
Amen.
And let me say that again. See, when we stop, when we change what we preach, it's because it profits us. If you want to fill up a church fast, tell them you believe that women now have the authority to preach in Church of Christ, and watch that church start to grow.
Mm-hmm.
Tell them in the Church of Christ that you have a problem with women working on the communion table, and watch women start showing up. Watch the church start to grow. You can grow or swell, but God's not doing that. If you want your church to grow, let a bunch of homosexuals make a singing group up here and start rocking the house and watch the church grow. Now what has that? You have to stop preaching against homosexuality. You have to stop preaching against women rolling in church. You have to stop preaching living a respectful life and start preaching watered down sermon that the apostles did not preach.
Amen.
Y'all all right?
Uh-huh.
And so what has happened is that you worried about something that's not your business. Can I tell you something, preachers? Is you have never brought anybody to the church.
Mm-hmm.
You don't baptize nobody. God asked to his church, such as should be saved. Elementary, that's 2, verse before it said, your job is just to preach the word. And in preaching the word will do its job. Right now, somebody came in the house of God right now, and this is between them and God, and they're sitting there thinking to themselves, you know what? I'm not worried about it, and I double-dog that dirty preacher to say something remotely about me. I'm going to let him have both barrels. They got hell in them, but then the Holy Spirit started moving, and the word of God started being preached. If it's preached without addition or subtraction, and the Spirit of God began to move on the people of God, and somebody leave out and saying, glory to his name!
Amen.
Remember last week, we had a young lady who was not feeling well today in a pregnancy, but she was sitting right here, and I asked her, said, what do you want? What would you like to do? Because I'm taking saving time. She said, I want it all. I want baptism. I want prayer. I want it all. I want Christ. You know, that's not the preacher's doing. Who's doing is that?
God.
That's not Anthony's doing. That's not his doing. That's not I. But who's doing is that?
God.
That's God's doing. But when a man thinks that it's about him, he begins to preach. He begins to think you can profit preaching. He'll change his lesson in order to profit or to get something for himself. But the church does not belong to men.
Amen.
The church belongs to Christ, our Lord and Savior. Here, I would recommend that the first approach to preaching is that we must return to introspective preaching. We must realize that in Acts chapter 2 was one of the largest crowds of people to be baptized. When the Lord added to the church some 3,000 and 5,000 souls, he did not preach prosperity. Am I right about it? He did not preach just come up reacting in a way that you would. He didn't even preach that you ought to worship like David. Am I right about it? Get from Acts chapter 2 by verse 29. Let's look at what Peter preached. When Peter preached, he preached a lesson that insists on change. He preached a lesson. This is his sermon. It's like, this is his preaching. And we got to preach what Peter preached. He didn't preach in the church would do. He didn't preach you to still do what you want to do. You might have came here a temple worshiper, but he now preached and said that the temple has changed in Jesus Christ. You might have came here one place or another. You might have came here and lead you, but you left here going that we are all one in Christ Jesus. He didn't preach the stuff that we hear now. And if you want the gospel to be profitable, you got to preach what the apostles preach.
Amen.
Regardless of how unpopular it is, you got to tell folk. Yeah, Matthew 16:18 is still relevant. Upon this rock, I'll build my church. Some folk get mad and roll their eyes. Some folk saw a line on the Bible. Well, yeah, he did build a church, but it's a spiritual church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Whatsoever shall be loose in heaven shall be loose on the earth. It's not just spiritual. It's down here on the earth. I'm right about it. You can make up every lie you want to and say it in that verse. That somehow that when Peter is talking about the church, that the church, he's the first pope that the church is built on Peter. But when we look at the scripture, what Peter actually preached, what Peter said in Matthew 16:18, Petros, he said that Jesus said unto him in Matthew chapter 17, but thou art Peter, and upon this rock flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, and upon your confession, that's the Petro, Peter is the Petro, that's his name, but the Petro, and upon your confession, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not what? Shall not prevail against it. You can't skip over that. He decided to build a church on men. He said, I'll build a church on the confession that I am the Son of God. And then you can enter into my rest. Amen. I don't know what's wrong with it, but we preach what Peter preached. Folk wouldn't be following Peter, they follow Jesus.
Amen.
Look at this scripture. The word, this is an amazing text to me. For the word did not profit. Maybe preaching is not possible. No, if you preach what they preach introspective sermons. In Acts 2, verse 29, what does the Bible say?
Men and brethren, let me speak freely unto you, the patriarch David.
The patriarchal dispensation of David. That David, hold on a minute, they said that David, was part of the patriarchal system. King says the patriarch says that God once spoke through in Hebrews 1 and verse 1, God is son of his time, and in times past spake to men through the prophets. He spake to us through the patriarchal system. He spake to us through kings. He spake to us through a system that was that now has been replaced through God's word. Am I right about it? So let me tell you something. When he's preaching, let me talk to you about that system. He said, David, that you're running over there in Psalms 150, when he said that everything that have breath, praise the Lord. He said, his kingship, his rule is what?
His dead.
Mm-hmm. You worship him in a dead environment. You might think you're alive. You just look alive. Don't let Drake fool you. He said, look alive. They're on the other side. Oh, well. I'm going to say we're crazy. Y'all all right. They look alive. But they're dead. Lost in sin. Peter preaches that they ain't alive. Let me tell you something. They're not letting it look like they're alive. Yeah. He's dead. He's dead. And his rule, his reign, the what he did and how he did is dead. What's the Bible say?
And his scepter
is with us
until this day.
Read.
There being a prophet. And knowing that God
has spoken. You have some people that love David. Am I right about it? Mm-hmm. You know, he said, now David has his 10,000, you have your 1,000. You have people that love, that gave their life to David. You had folk who loved David. And you had a preacher that got up in front of the folks, said, I don't care how much you love David. David is dead and he's buried. Can I tell you this? Don't get mad at me, but your mom and dad is dead and buried. You're not following your mom and dad. You're following Christ. And I write about it. Your mom and dad didn't come to the body of Christ. I don't know what to tell you. But church is not about your family. It's not about your genealogy. It's not about your cousin, your friend. He said the church is not established on a David mentality. Yeah. It's dead and it's buried.
Uh-huh.
And see, he did not finish reading. Who always followed me?
And that the fruit of his loins,
according
to the flesh, he would rise up
to sit on his throne.
He said this before spake the resurrection of Christ.
His soul was not left in hell.
Neither was the flesh see corruption.
And the right about to read.
This Jesus that God raised up.
Whereof we are all witness.
Therefore,
I love this. Therefore, being the prophet
right man, on the right hand
of God, exalted. He's exalted. He's been raised up. He's been exalted past temple worship. He's been exalted past instrumental work. He's been exalted past what men thought about him. The lies you told about him can't hurt him no. He's been exalted past us, and he's on the right hand side of God. Join some other church if you want to. You lift your eyes up in hell. Join the David system if you want to. Join the Hebrew life if you want to. You lift your eyes up in hell. How do you know even a Stephen, when he was over in Acts chapter 7, around the 50-something verse he was preaching, he said, you stiff-necked generation, you killed all the prophets, you murdered everybody that God sent to you. And that's the Bible said they had an introspective look at themselves. They were pricked in the heart. And as they were stoning Stephen to death for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, he said, I looked and I saw Jesus standing on the right hand side of God. And you can kill me as a preacher if you want to, but you'll never be able to hurt Jesus. Sometimes you will come to realize you're going to have to see him again standing on the right hand side of God. For behold, he comes with clouds and he comes with angels. He has fire and vengeance in his eyes. And his sword is with him. His judgment is with him. I'm telling you right now, for everybody that denies the church of Christ, God says, I'll deny you on the other side. You're going to every tongue shall confess and every mouth, every head shall bow and admit that he is the Son of God. And if he's the Son of God, and I know he is, the Son built the church, and I write about it. Bible says, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye him. There's no other church but the Lord's church. Any other church belongs to some man. We're not following some man, but we're following Jesus Christ. Don't care how good your ideals are. We got to preach what the apostles preach.
Amen.
The apostles did not preach a watered-down version concerning the church. Drop down to verse 37. Peter kept on preaching that day. He explained there had been a change of guards. He asked them to have an introspective look and to see all that God had done for them, had given his life on Calvary's cross for the sins, and how the heaven and the universe came together, did not leave him in hell or the grave, neither did his flesh see corruption. But he raised him up and said, sit here on thy right hand side, so I make your enemies your footstool. Am I right about it? They kept on preaching that. They said, ye men of Israel, you took him and you crucified him. Some of you this morning are crucifying the Son of God afresh. Hebrews 6 and 5. How are you crucifying? Worshiping it in vain. So I don't know about the Bible anymore. Do you know about the blood of Jesus Christ? Because the Bible is covered with the blood of Jesus Christ. People died so you can have God's word in your hand. They sacrificed their life. What you mean you don't know about the Bible? You read Betty Crocker, don't you? If it say 3 eggs, don't you put 3 eggs in? If it say 2 eggs, don't you say put some sugar and water? Why can't you believe the Bible?
Amen.
Sunday school teacher made an excellent point today. He said the internet has been around some years. And you'll take some of the internet, and most time it's lying. They lied on me, they get on that lie. And you'll believe whatever's on the internet. But then you open your Bible, which has been here over 2,000 years. And you look at the Bible and say, I don't know, that's just a book written by me. What's the internet written by?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know who Wikipedia is?
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand who Wikipedia, do you know? Who Apple is? Better not that. Why is Wikipedia and Google smarter than? you read that, you'll find he talks about the resurrection. He talks about the death and what God did. Then he said, let me tell you something. When the people heard this, it said, here's the thing. If you come to church any Sunday morning, I'm almost there. You come to church any Sunday morning, and the word is preached, and you don't allow the word of God inside, and you talk your way through service, and you chew gum through service, and you sleep through service, and you think about your bills through service, you work on your phone through service, and you sit there, you look up in there, and you do everything. So the word of God will never reach a person who does not allow the word of God inside his heart.
Amen.
It's not that the word of God is bad. It's a nasty heart that don't want to receive the word of God.
Amen.
So until we have an introspective meeting of the minds with God's word, there will always be a disconnect from the Spirit of God. For the word is the Spirit, and the Spirit is the word.
Amen.
And until my heart is open to receive God's word, I'll never be a child of God.
Uh-huh.
Some of you right now, sitting there right now, I can preach right down your street and take exactly what you're doing through the Holy Spirit. Tell you the consequence of what you're doing. But as long as that heart like what you're doing, and folk tell you it's all right to do what you're doing, you'll sit right there and you'll look at me, and you'll get up and you'll say amen, and you'll walk out that door and go right back to doing what you're doing.
Amen.
How many people do you know who walked out the house of God and went straight to a motel for one thing? How many people you know who walked out the house of God, just heard the word of God, and went right back to a bottle of Jig Jack? How many people that you know who heard the word of God walk right out there and start fussing and cussing, talking about somebody as bad as they can? I'm kind of like Cardi B. I don't mess with nobody. I just tell you, if I see you and I don't speak, that means. I don't mess with you. I don't spend my time talking about folk, messing with folk. But if I see you, I don't fool with you. But yet we live in people who have no introspect. Look, the word of God cannot reach them, and the men of God have been held liable. And the writer said, the word of God was preached unto us as well as unto them, but it did not profit, not being mixed with faith. Why is it not mixed? Because it was not allowed to be mixed. But what was allowed to be mixed was false doctrine. And what's been allowed to be mixed today, what we are receiving are new religions and new belief systems. What we are receiving is new thoughts and changes from Jehovah's Witnesses. What we are receiving, the idea that the woman's role has been expanded. What we are receiving is that somehow we're wrong and suddenly other folk are right. What we are receiving.